Good morning and God bless you. We're delighted to have you with us here this morning. Maybe this is your first time tuning in and joining us. We extend a warm welcome to you and trust that you're blessed with what you hear today. We want to begin with prayer. We want to continue to pray for the direction and the condition of our world. We want to pray for our local community and region. We also want to remember Cornerstone Pentecostal Church. And lastly, our brothers and sisters around the world. Maybe you have a special unspoken request. It's a perfect time to make that known unto God. Let's pray together. Father, by the authority of the name of Jesus, we come, we ask God in Jesus' name that you will keep your hand upon this world. We pray for great, unprecedented revival everywhere, everywhere, everywhere. Great, unprecedented Holy Ghost revival. We pray for the influence and the impact of the Word of God, the Spirit of God, and the people of God upon our world in this hour. We pray for our local community and region and pray you'll open up doors of utterance and influence. Maybe just somebody on the job, somebody at school, somebody in their neighborhood. We pray for doors of opportunity to open. We also pray for Cornerstone Pentecostal Church. Pray that you'll open up the windows of heaven, pour out your divine favor. And lastly, our brothers and sisters around the world, missionaries in Brazil, missionaries in the Middle East, missionaries all over the world, you'll furnish them with a hedge of protection. We ask all this in the name above every name, the name of Jesus Christ. Everybody said, amen. Praise God. Want to direct your attention to one verse of scripture, even though we're going to read several more, but I want to just get this. Hebrews chapter number 11 and verse number 32. And what shall I more say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and of Barak and of Samson and of Jephthah, of David also, and Samuel and of the prophets who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, etc., etc. Developing an exit strategy. And I want to talk to us about Samson. Let's read verse number one. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it, the elders obtained a good report. And then it starts from there and reveals to us kind of a going into a hall with all these wonderful portraits of great and impacting saints of the Old Testament, Abraham and Moses and Jacob, and talking about some of the great exploits of faith. We just mentioned Abraham, but Abraham is brought out in detail because he journeyed into the unknown. And then in our reading, we see that there's a collection of other names. David is only mentioned in verse number 32. You would have thought that David, but no, David is mentioned in verse 32. But in the same verse as David and Samuel, who some regard as the greatest prophet of the Old Testament because he was transitional. Samuel was transitional. Is Samson. Samson. What is Samson doing in the hall of faith? He has a portrait there. He had more than just an honorable mention. There's other people that aren't mentioned there, but Samson is mentioned in Hebrews chapter number 11. Samson, of course, is a special child. He was born to a a barren womb. He's one of only three people mentioned in the entire Word of God who was named by an angel. And of course, you understand that he had a special vow. He has a special vow and a requirement of separation to maintain that empowerment to serve God's people as a deliverer in the book of Judges. The book of Judges is an extremely important book in the Old Testament. It is a book of transition, how that the nation of Israel, that first generation that came out of Egyptian bondage, and it's their children now that they've heard about the great deliverance of coming out of over 400 years of Egyptian bondage, and now they're transitioning into the promised land. And it's their children that were nomadic. They were raised in the wilderness, but now they're going into the promised land. And there was no theocracy. You would have thought that God it would have been strong enough in them that they would have established a theocracy. They already have a prophet that represents God to the people, and they already have a priest that represents the people before God, but that wasn't strong enough, for every man did that which was right in their own eyes. You know the story of Judges. Incredible book. But because the nation of Israel was in this adjustment period of adjusting in the promised land, they didn't get some things right. They still fell into idolatry, and God would raise up their enemies, and they would need deliverance from their enemies. And so God would raise up deliverers in the book of Judges. And Samson was one of those deliverers. Incredible exploits, but Samson was a fornicator. He was a massive fornicator, and he lusted after things that we ought not desire. You understand the story that he got messed up with the wrong woman and finally spilled his guts and revealed that his power was based on his separation, a vow of separation. And when his hair got cut, the power left. What qualified Samson to be in Hebrews chapter number 11? Now, there's probably a variety of different ways that other people would look at this. This is my take on Samson. He only had two recorded prayer meetings in the entirety of his adult life. And one of his prayer meetings is he is finally between the two pillars. He has a hand on this pillar and a hand on that pillar. And Samson realized, what a fool I have been. I have squandered the things that God has placed in my life. I've done a few exploits, but I really messed up. And so, why don't I go out with doing more damage to the enemy than I ever did in my life? It just so happened that on top of these two pillars, there was on the roof, there was over 3,000 of the Philistine enemies, the princes and the aristocracy among the Philistines that were all having a party over the condition and the shape of Samson. And probably no doubt their parting was having the victory over God's people. And this, we finally have Samson, and he has no power to harm us anymore. And he could hear all of that while he was placed between two pillars. And he came to the place of realizing, I'm going to go out. I'm going to go out. And I'm going to take every single one of these with me. So Samson on the spot, without his eyes, without his power, after walking in circles, making bread for the enemy at the mill, being tormented and tortured and being led by a little child, he developed an exit strategy. Maybe I'm talking to somebody here this morning that maybe you realize I've squandered a lot of opportunities. I've made a lot of mistakes in my life. I've done this, I've done that, I've done this. We could all do that. What can you do with the last remaining moments of your Christianity? You're still here, you're still breathing, you can still pray, you can still give a Bible study, you can still knock a door, you can still call up people that you haven't talked to for years and say, hey, I forgive you, I love you, I just want to talk to you about the goodness and the grace of God. Maybe it's becoming something, doing something, developing an exit strategy. The devil understands how human nature works, that if he can get us to mess up bad enough, that he thinks that he can park us and doesn't have to worry about us anymore. But here's Samson between the two pillars, and he prays a prayer, God, empower me one last time, and let me take out the enemy with me. What can we do with one last thrust against the enemy? A lot more than you think you can. You can still knock a door. You can still witness. You can still testify. I'm not listening to the devil anymore. I'm not listening to my failures anymore. I'm not listening to the laughs of the crowd anymore. I will not be deterred. I'm going to develop an exit strategy that my latter end will be greater than my beginning. God bless you. Thank you for joining us. We'll look forward to seeing you tomorrow.